Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Mononofu podcast, a bi-weekly podcast focusing on news and topics related to the idol group Momoiro Clover Z. I'm Aaron. We had a first episode, and we're trying this again. I'm Aaron. Nice to meet you. Everyone else?
I am Mark, or Social Anime Guy. And finally?
And yeah, I'm David Nemurenata.
Yes, we said finally because we are a man down.
Yeah. And unfortunately, this is a graduation of sorts. Jake has graduated from our group finally. And now we can become an even greater podcast.
Introducing we will this evolve. Week.
We will evolve. Introducing this week, the Mononofu Podcast Z.
Zed. No,
like Pokemon.
He's not graduated. He's just like, he's gone to New York, and we think he's asleep. So, yeah. Rip.
Rest in peace.
Yeah, so we will be a man down for this episode, but he might come in at some point, and he'll be here next week if not. So, what have you all been up to then?
Well, I had exams, and I still have exams coming up. Then on Saturday, I graduate high school, finally. Thank God.
Well, I've done not much more than studying, so I can't really say that much.
Yeah, busy finals week for me. Very busy finals week. I would like to point out that Jake is online, though.
Oh, well, that solves that, I guess.
Yeah, so I guess for not becoming Mononofu Podcast Z.
Damn.
For now, we just need to find a way to knock him off sometime.
Oh, hey, speaking of knocking off people,
speaking please of the
welcome
devil.
Our fourth member. Hello.
You sound wrecked.
How's it going, Jake?
Oh dear. Good start.
I'm really slow.
Okay.
But I can try my best.
Do your best.
Ganbatte. I was literally like, I didn't sleep at all.
On
a flight from Honolulu to New York.
That's not good.
Yeah. It was
Hey, we're doing it for the podcast, right? We're doing it for the podcast.
Yep.
Just gotta fight through. You can collapse afterwards.
Oh yeah, I probably will too.
Anyway,
welcome back to the mainland.
Yeah, it's a cool place, and it's really cold. I'm talking. It snowed today. Cold.
It snowed.
Yeah.
Dang.
Right.
That doesn't exist here.
Yeah. Well, what is that? That thing? Powdery kind of white stuff. What is that?
Yeah, there was like ice rained down.
Ice rained?
Yeah.
Wow. Anyway,
is that like hail? I don't know.
A little bit, except it wasn't like huge or anything.
Yeah. Anyway, welcome to the Mononofu podcast where we talk about Momoiro Clover Z all the time, 24/7.
Except for the time when we're talking about hail and or like before the podcast where we're talking about battered Mars bars.
Okay, you had to throw that in anyway. We do have some news headlines to cover. Mark, would you please tell us the wonderful news?
All right then. So I think the first news we should cover is probably some concert news. That sounds like a good place to start, do you not think? Mm-hmm. So let's go into the fact that we have some stuff on the Tojinsai concerts. I know that there's a couple of international Mononofu who are possibly going to be going to that concert, and we got some ticket news for that, where for Angel Eyes members, the tickets will be available between the 18th and the 24th of May. for application, and I think the results are announced in the beginning of June. Yeah, I think that was it. I'd have to check the exact date, but the applications start on the 18th for Angelized members for the 2 days. We also got some news on the dates for Irene's solo concert, which is September 19th.
Hey.
Which
means... Yeah, that's a couple of days away from my birthday.
Hey.
Nice. Rennie's solo concert on my birthday.
Dude, awesome. Wow.
You should go.
Yeah, a bit difficult too, but, you know, we can try. But yeah, we've got Arin's on September 19th. We then have Momotomai's 2 weeks earlier on the 4th. Momoka's is on July.
That's the day before mine.
it all links to our birthday. It's too much to be a coincidence, almost.
Dang. Except me.
Rip. But yeah, we have Momoka's Feel a Heartbeat concert.
Yay.
On the 3rd of July. And the Angel Eyes tickets are still on application until midnight tomorrow, Japan time. And then Rennie's third solo is on March the 9th next year. I still think it's weird that we know that so far in advance.
Yeah.
And yet we don't know anything about the tour for America.
That's ironic.
Well, we didn't even hear about the summer concerts until the end of the Dome Trek, which was April, and that's August. So yeah, a bit late notice for a lot of things, but then they give us a year's notice for the solo.
Interesting.
Well, they let us know that they're doing the U.S. concert, but they have not released any info yet.
Which is something.
A lot of people are speculating an announcement will come soon, though.
Well, based off what?
I saw it on a few tweets that a few Japanese people are saying that they've been saying that they're gonna announce stuff soon. Maybe it was with Arin's live thingy, but that nothing came out of there. So.
Oh yeah, recently I saw a bunch of tweets on Twitter relating to Arin and her being at a store or something, and she was signing stuff. What was that about?
There was a couple of members, I think, which actually links on to the next bit of news. Just recently, the Otoko Matsuri Blu-ray has just launched in Japan.
Eh.
Which... I still am in love with the cover for this Blu-ray.
It's very manly.
It is very, very manly. Whoever did the art for that cover did a really, really good job of it.
Didn't they get someone to do that for them?
They did. I'm trying to think who it was.
Like someone with an actual, someone that's actually known?
Yeah, I'd have to check the name, and I have to look it up because I forgot to beforehand. I think it's a mangaka for one of the 80s mangas, but I can't remember the name.
Oh well, we'll look it up. We'll put it in the show notes if anything.
We will. And the poster, the poster that comes with the Amazon edition, that is really nice because it's just that art blown up onto a B2 size poster. And I'm
all I've seen from that concert so far is Momoka winking, and I cried.
Oh, I think the Link Link performance from that concert got online somewhere, and I was watching that, and I was like, "Whoa! I really need to get this concert at some point."
Oh, okay. This guy who did the art, he's a pretty big name.
Pretty big.
I don't have his name, but he did do the art for Hokuto no Shinken, also known as Fist of the North Star.
I thought it was him. What's his name again?
Tetsuo Hara.
Dang, I did not know that.
It does look like his art, to be fair. That's what I was thinking of, but I just couldn't pinpoint who it was.
Yeah. That is definitely really cool. If you're into Fist of the North Star, you're into MomoClo, she definitely get that Blu-ray. Did any of us get it though?
Nope.
I have no money to, so rip.
Not yet.
I'm getting the Christmas Blu-ray that comes out like next month, so that's more of my priority because it's like 3 days plus a CD.
Well, when you do get it, like, let us know on the podcast how it is.
I will have to. There is someone in the chat who's actually getting it, having a look at this.
Yeah. What's up, chat?
Hey, guys.
Anyway, I would actually get that because I really like the Matsuris they do. My favorite one so far out of all the Matsuris is Onna Matsuri 2014. Really
still
good
haven't
concert.
Seen that one.
It's
really good. Watch it.
That's the restaurant, isn't it? The restaurant MCZ.
Yes.
I have that Blu-ray. It is such a good concert.
It is.
I just love the outfits I've got for that concert.
Yes. I kind of don't like the ones they do for Pinky Jones though.
I could see that, but I like all the outfits in that concert. So.
Yes.
I'm just waiting for the 20 disc mega set that they'll end up doing for the Dome Trek.
Oh boy.
I don't think they'll do every concert from the Dome Trek.
No, they'll probably do the biggest one and then just like they did for the Fifth Dimension tour.
Yeah. They may possibly do, the thing is they'll probably do Cebu because that was a big date. But Osaka, the one I went to, actually I think that was a bigger venue. If I remember right, because I think Thebe was only about 25,000 and Kyocera was about 30. So they may do have both of those in, but I have my doubts. Anyway, moving on. The last bit of news I think might be worth mentioning is the new merch that's available at the moment.
Oh, yeah. I love merch.
Yeah. Yeah. In case the Blu-rays didn't make your wallet cry, then. We've got the merch.
A lot of stuff went up. Well, it looks like a lot of stuff. It actually is like a couple of stuff. First things first, the jackets are back, the solid color jackets. You can get those. They come in like three variants. There's the normal ones, then there's the big ones. And then they also have like a new variant. It's called Long. I'm not sure what's so long about it.
The sleeves, I think, are a bit longer on those ones. For if you've got long arms.
Like or the, if you...
Like the big ones, like, longer on the front.
Yeah. Like if you're just one of those people that likes long sleeves, you could probably get that.
Yeah.
They also have matching shorts and skirts.
Tammy says on the chat that the skirt can be worn as a shirt, apparently.
If you're small
yeah, I
enough.
Can see that.
I don't know how long the skirt is, though. And to be honest, I don't think it's what I plan to be picking up.
Yeah. Oh, well. Yeah. So then they had these bargain bag things for like...
Wait, hold on. That's the big thing. You gotta announce the other thing first.
What is the other little thing?
The MomoClo dress straps.
Oh, yeah.
The dress straps are back, yeah.
Yeah, and they have the dress straps. They're back. It's their outfit where they look like Power Rangers from Zed No Den sets. And lastly, there is the neatest thing, but it's already sold out.
Done.
Yeah, we were looking forward to announcing this, and then we were like, oh, wait, it's already gone.
Yeah, the bags had... 16,000 yen worth of official merchandise for 5,000 yen, but they went pretty damn fast, so...
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was like a bag, that was like a grab bag, it had, you know, that much stuff in it, so you can get like a bunch of that stuff. You could also opt to get a specific member, if I remember correctly.
That was only for fan club members.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Only on five.
And the merchandise included in that were like shirts and towels and other things.
Fan Club also had some higher tiers of it. Like you could get a 23,000 yens worth of merch bag.
So basically, this is like all the extras that they wanted to get out.
Yeah.
Or something like that.
Actually, speaking of the fan club, if you are in the fan club, then they do have the winter versions of the jackets, shorts and skirts, available as well.
The ones that they sold for the Christmas concert last year?
The ones with like the block colored hoods, and then they've got like the patterns on the jacket
Oh,
itself,
okay.
those ones.
Right,
Oh, yeah.
and
They're
And
available.
the, what's it called? These bags were also only, you could only pay at, on order. So you'd have to, it'd have to be paid for at the door when they ship it to you, which I don't know how that would work for international fans, but.
Yeah, they had to pay on the door at the fan club, which was a really weird thing. But then I think they changed that for when they put it on the general store.
No, it was still this. Well, they didn't say anything about it, but I have no idea. If I bought one, I would have been able to say, but it was sold out.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure that some forwarding services might have been able to help you with that if you would like contact them about the product. Like you gotta let them know that it's cash on delivery, and they would probably set up something with you. But too
Yeah.
late now, it's sold out.
Rip.
Rip.
There were also some restocks on the website. Arin Robo went up again. Not the toy, the
Damn
shirt.
it.
The
Shirt.
shirt.
Want that.
Which
The
also
shirt
went
went
very
up.
quickly.
That went pretty quickly. It's also sold out right now. They restocked on the Huffies, but it's only the black one. I think the other ones are actually discontinued now.
Rip. No,
Because
I don't think so. The
they're always sold out and they always come back up at some point.
Yeah, but previous times where they sold out and came back, they were still on the website. You just couldn't purchase them. Now they're no longer on the website. It's just the black one.
Right. Yeah, they only give you an option for the Hako, but I would just assume that they were other the others were sold out, but yeah, that's true. They're not listed on there anymore.
The Happies were available at the Osaka concert, all the colors, as well as the Hako one. I remember that. Oh, that might be the MomoClo-chan ones.
But like this happened after the Dome Tour concert.
That is true. That is true. Anyway.
Surprisingly, you can still get the winter snow gloves.
Oh, I'm tempted to get those snow
Definitely
gloves.
need that in California.
I know it's so terrible. We don't need that, but I want it.
At least here it's cold enough that you've got an excuse to wear the gloves from time to time. And they are nice gloves. They are really nice gloves.
They're really nice. Very simple design. They have the logo color. It looks amazing. That's still up. Interestingly enough, they also have the pen light from the Dome Tour and
All the
some other
Dome
Dome Tour
Trek
stuff.
merch, apart from the stuff that sold out instantly, is up there, including the food as well. I recommend the rice crackers. Those were the rice biscuit sort of things. They're the ones I got at the Dome Trek, and they were nice. They've got the ones for the different regions because it varied by region as well. So they've got all the different bits of food if you want some Japanese food. Anyway, I think we should move on to our next segment, should we?
Which segment is that? Is that mine?
Yes, it's your segment. Your chance to
Yay.
shine.
Okay, well, I gotta preface this segment up. I got a MomoClo Mononofu confession to make, guys.
What
It's
could that possibly be?
keep it on the down low, but I actually haven't listened to one of their albums.
How could
And
you?
it's Amaranthus I didn't listen
Tisk
to.
tisk.
Are you even a Mononofu?
Yeah, man. I lift. Don't worry about it. But no, I didn't actually listen to Amaranthus the first time. And here's my excuse. I wanted to give it an active listen, but I haven't had the time to do that in a long time. And just recently, I realized that I had some time, so I listened a little bit of it. And here's a new segment. It's called Amaranthus or Amaranthus. And what we're gonna do, we're gonna go each week. That we have the podcast. We're gonna go over two songs. I'm gonna give you my opinion on what I think about each of the songs, from the Amaranthus album.
Yeah, and the first two songs we'll be covering is just the prologue and We Are Born.
Yeah, it's actually called Embryo.
Embryo, yes.
Embryo prologue.
It fits the theme of birth and rebirth quite well.
Yeah, so I listened to that song for the first time. I have some notes written down here, so I'm going to go through them. One thing that was really weird about that song was the baby noises.
Hey, it made sense, fam.
It makes sense, but here's the thing that, like, I don't see it benefiting the song in any way. It's very tense, you know, it's kind of like a build-up, right? It's building up to something. And when I compare that song to the prologue in Hakin no Yoake's prologue kind of like prefaces the whole album. Like you would listen to that song for the whole album.
Yeah.
You would listen, that would be the first song you listen to, and then it kind of like sets the frame for the whole album. In Amaranthus, again, I haven't listened to the rest of the album, just the first two songs, but I feel like this song is only prefacing one song after it.
Well, I could argue that Embryo, the way that plays out musically is very similar stylistically to one of the tracks off of the Gone Tour soundtrack.
Yeah.
Oh, you mean how the Fifth Dimension, like the first track on Fifth Dimension, was prefaced by the orchestral song?
Yeah, sort of. Have you guys listened to the Gone Tour soundtrack?
The Gone soundtrack. Oh yeah, yeah, yeah,
yeah. Yeah, it sounds like one of the tracks off of there. I think it's trying to build sort of a connection with that, because I don't know, it makes sense to me.
Well, they have their own little overarching arc with some of their music videos, so it's sort of linking into that as well.
I think it's a perfect, you know, preface, but it's a perfect preface for We Are Born, and I don't think it'll be prefacing the entire album. I haven't listened to it, of course, but I only listened to those two songs, but I feel like this is mainly for We Are Born.
I mean,
I will agree that I guess if you haven't listened to it, but I kind of get what you're trying to say here. And most of the songs aren't really about birth specifically as We Are Born is, like, really deliberately about it. It's more the, as you get closer to the end of the album, it's more about the rebirth than the birth itself. And I'm gonna just say right now that I vastly prefer the Hakin no Yoake prologue to Embryo. Rarely ever listen to Embryo, but I listen to the other one all the time. So
I think as a song, I would agree, but in terms of prefacing the album, I would actually disagree. With it being just a preface for the song, I think it does preface the entire album, simply because if you think about the way the album progresses, I almost have it in my head as being like the events of life. I actually wrote this because I actually did make my own notes as well, because I was trying to think a bit, and I think of Embryo as being like the whole thing of the concept of life. Like, you've got the embryo being, like, the pregnancy, like, the before life. We Are Born, obviously, is birth. The rest of it's sort of the events. Like, you can take when some of the other tracks coming in, like, Seishun Fu, take that as when they're graduating school and growing up and stuff like that. And then as it's going to the end, it's starting to be their death and then their rebirth with Happy Rebirth Day. And then that links into Hakin no Yoake in a way that's, like, oh, well, this is almost like the process of rebirth, the psychedelic reimagining of their birth, coming back to life through, you could almost say, heaven, or through a dreamlike world. And that's why you've got a lot more experimental tracks.
Right. So they go to heaven, and then right after being satiated or like being in there for a while, they gotta rock the boat.
Momokuro Tengoku.
Rock the butt.
Yeah, you gotta rock the butt.
Okay, my next note about the song is that I wouldn't even really consider it an MCC song because they're not even in it.
Mm.
Well, I mean, you could say that about Or Fortuna in Fifth Dimension.
Yeah.
And that was cheesy.
Our Fortune is the song that came before the first track, isn't it?
Neo Stargate, yeah.
Neo
Stargate's 8 minutes long.
Yeah, I remember listening to that album for the first time, and the music show that airs in the UK called X Factor.
Yeah.
And
yeah, that's here too. It's here too.
Oh yeah, it came over there recently, didn't it? But like, when I first heard that, they used that track in like introducing that show. So the first time I heard this album, because I put it on like full blast, I just got the biggest fright ever. I didn't know what to expect.
Yeah. It's kind of like the cliche of cliches, almost.
Yeah.
Okay, and then...
Should we move into We Are Born, actually?
I'll go through my other points about the song real quick. I do like the heartbeat effect throughout the entire song, kind of as the beat that kind of drives the song. Pretty good, and it fits into the theme. I mean, it just makes a big point that this is an intro song. I mean, it doesn't really stand that well on its own. No. I like the reverse instruments used in comparison to Haki no Yake. This one kind of is not that good. But then we have We Are Born, and I really like that song. It's really good. Love it. Love the guitars in it. And
a lot of people don't like it.
Really?
Really?
Yeah.
I've never heard anyone say they don't like it, actually.
The drummer for Baby Metal's in that song.
Is it?
A lot of people don't like it because they feel like, oh, MomoClo is just catering to generic J-pop now, or J-rock or whatever.
Yeah, generic. I can see that. Right. I can definitely see that.
Right. That's generic? How?
MomoClo...
Because it sounds like everything else, apparently.
No, it doesn't.
Nah. And even if
you want to hear everything else, listen to any other idol group. Yeah. Like, literally.
Even if you think that, MomoClo always go into loads of different styles when they're doing their music. And this is just one of it. And even then, I would argue that instead of just being J-rock, it transitions into a couple of different styles during that song.
Yeah.
So I wouldn't
Heck,
even...
It,
only the start of it, really.
I mean, even that ending is like romantic piano, like it's like 19th century Chopin.
Yeah.
I have an opinion about the ending.
Go ahead.
The ending to We Are Born, where it just cuts to the piano and it kind of does the dun, 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 that part. I don't like it.
Why not?
Oh,
I feel like the entire song before that, like it just doesn't fit. I don't think it's a fitting end. The piano is throughout the song, right? You can hear it going, you know, right? But I don't think it's unique enough, or it doesn't really stand out to me. And then by the time the song finishes, I'm just like, oh yeah, there was a piano in the song. And I think it kind of stretches on for too long in the end. I would expect like a big band finish at the end or something like that, but it kind of goes to the piano and I'm just like,
I think if there is a criticism you're going to make, is it might be that section's a little too long. It is a good 30 plus seconds. But even then, I think it fits because of the fact that you've got it bookended by the piano. You've got a transition in the different styles throughout. And then it almost like leads into the piano, I'd argue, instead of theming out of place, even if that section is probably a little long.
I don't know. Like the thought that came into my head at that part of the song was like, you know, I don't think it would be that cool of a cool finish if I was, you know, hearing this song live at concert and it ended on that piano. Like I would kind of just be like, there's a piano part. I don't really like it that much.
It gives them a breather.
I mean, like, compared to, like, Moon Pride, where it's, like, a, you know, rock, pretty much, like, rock-influenced song the entire time, they have, like, a big finish at the end, where it's, like, something like that, right? For this song, it's just a pretty kind of long ending in piano. It's not, well, like, a big finish.
Yeah, I mean...
What if in a live concert, it was done with, like, a big string section instead of a piano?
Oh, was it?
No.
Well, no, what if it was?
Oh, what if it was?
Yeah. Like, would it be rearranged in a way to where it wasn't just a piano?
If it's rearranged at any point or for any reason in any way, I think it would be better.
Jeez.
Well, let's ask the person who actually went to the concert that played it. Mark.
The piano intro does work better than the piano outro, but the outro doesn't feel out of place at the ending. Because at the same time, you've not listened to the rest of the album. The next track works with the piano ending.
Wait, hold on. What's the second song after We're Born?
It's MomoClo Desen, the one that.
Oh yeah, and that song starts out slow too.
Yeah.
So.
Okay. That is actually the one thing that would save it for me. Because at the end, I was like, okay, so either this song ends pretty. Not that great, or they're leading into something else.
Yeah, the album does a good job of leading in one song to the next.
Yeah, except for the whole parade thing.
Hmm. What do you mean?
You know, in the music video for We Are Born, they have a parade, but the actual parade doesn't start until 6 tracks later.
Fair point.
There's a little bit of a continuity error there.
Yeah.
I mean,
what was I gonna say?
Go ahead.
I'm trying to actually remember what I was gonna say. Oh yeah. With the piano intro though, the one thing I will say about the concert, it was the first concert I've gone to, but the way they started it is like they had the piano intro and then you know how they scream like oh
yeah
right at the start. As soon as they do that, they've got they've got huge bangs as what they come up from underneath the stage and there's these huge bangs that like smoke shots to come out of the stage.
Oh, like pyro.
Yeah, like I literally almost got the fright of my life and almost like had a heart attack there and then because it was so loud when they come out because they're screaming as well, and then you've got the bang and then you've got like the whole crowd as well. It's like, man. Plus I did have the advantage on first day of being quite close to the stage, although after that start I was starting to question whether that was an advantage.
Yes, it was. That sounds awesome.
Definitely, yeah. I was when I went to AX, I was second row in the pit, so I was right next to the speaker, and I can tell you the hearing loss was totally worth it.
Oh, it was worth it, but like I almost physically died at that point.
I have a question. When they came out from under the stage with the Ogya, was it on the O or the Gya when they came up with the pyro?
With the pyrotechnics.
Like yeah. by the pyrotechnics went up on O, but by the time they actually got up on the stage they were shouting the Gya.
That's intense. Oh. That's like sensory overload right there almost.
Oh, it was insane.
That sounds awesome though, and that's what I really like about this song, is just that it starts and it's just like, oh yeah, and then boom, you're in it, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, and if you listen to that drum track, it's definitely the one from Baby Metal, the drummer.
I didn't actually realize until you mentioned it that the drummer from Baby Metal was in it.
Yeah, that's not something I found out myself. There was a guy in a Facebook group I'm an admin for, and he was talking about this album, and he said, yeah, the drummer, God, from Baby Metal is on this track. And when you listen to it, you can definitely hear it. Those drum fills and everything, that's him. It really is.
Wait.
It's awesome.
Was his name God?
They have a commie band, so like yeah. A God band.
Yeah.
Oh, speaking of God... here's a little note I found in We Are Born. Does Kaneko say like like, hey boy, right? She says that, right?
She says, hey girl, but it sounds like, hey God.
Yeah. Oh, okay, okay. I thought you said, hey God.
Hey God? Yeah.
Hey God, how's it hanging?
That actually, like, reminds me of Haki no Yoake, because they actually talk about God a little bit in that album.
Yeah. Mm.
So I'm, like, thinking when I first hear that, like, what is with, like, the religious stuff in these two albums, man?
Oh, actually, you know what else I noticed about the Amaranthus artwork?
What?
They kind of look like the way they're dressed up in those uniforms and, you know, with the makeup the way it is. It kind of looks like the get-up for the, like, Mexican Day of the Dead.
Yeah.
Holiday. I think that's
what it's based on.
Yeah, I thought that was really cool too.
Yeah, and I was originally going to get Amaranthus because of that. Since I'm Mexican, I thought that they really did, like, I thought that was pretty cool that they did that.
Yeah.
But I ended up going for Haki no Yoake instead.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I don't blame you. That one looks better.
Yeah, the album art looked pretty cool.
But, I mean, once you get over the busyness of the Amaranthus one, it really looks awesome.
Because
mm-hmm. the Amaranthus one is pretty busy.
I always preferred the Amaranthus art to the Haki no Yoake one. I like the Haki no Yoake one, but the Amaranthus art, I always thought that was cool, but I really loved the big band outfits. It's probably some of my favorite outfits I've done.
Same.
Yeah, I mean, it's a very nice go-to outfit for their current, like, promotion season.
Yeah.
Promoting the new albums, all that stuff. It's a very nice go-to outfit. Works in a lot of situations.
I like the fact they've got the instrument, especially because I actually used to play flute, and Shirin holds a flute during it.
Hey.
So who I've holds got that... the banjo? I forgot.
Rennie.
I think that's awesome.
Momoka's got the drum, fittingly.
Right.
Oh, yeah. Well, I'll get to a point after you're done.
Arin's got the French horn, and then Kaneko's got the conductor's baton.
The baton, yeah. I actually have my copy of both those albums with me.
Anyway, speaking of Momoka drums, my favorite part of the song, and I will always remember this song on this part, it's the part with Momoka. That is the best part. Where it just, like, starts building up, the drums are, like, really powerful, and Momoka is just kind of like, she's basically going Super Saiyan at this point. She's, like, powering up, and you just get all that build up, and it's awesome, you know. And you're like, yeah, Momoka, go! And then Rennie,
yeah,
baby, that's baby, none this.
Yeah, that part's really awesome. I really like that.
The puppets do such a good job in the music video as well.
I love that.
Yeah, I kind of like the juxtaposition. That's what I like about Momoka in general. The juxtaposition, she has a strong voice, but she's the smallest member.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah, that's what, she is a small-sized giant for a reason.
Yeah. But that Rennie bit, sorry, I don't like it.
Why?
You can't.
It fakes you out. That's the cool thing about it.
I will admit 100% that builds character, and I like the charm in it. I appreciate the charm, but, like, I felt like this, like, it could have been cooler if they actually did something after the buildup, other than, you know, the Rennie bit.
Yeah. If we're gonna make comments on the music video, one thing I do think needs to be mentioned: Arin's anime section.
That was interesting.
That was awesome.
They're just teasing us with, like, a MomoClo anime at this point.
Yeah, when is the MomoClo anime?
I'm like, oh, look, more anime, huh?
Who's going to do the MomoClo anime?
Hopefully not some shit studio.
Hey! Oh,
well, I'm trying to think who could do it.
Shaft?
Oh,
definitely.
Shaft would be brilliant to do it. I would actually be really interested if it's not going to happen, but with the way the artwork would look, I would love to see Makoto Shinkai actually direct a MomoClo movie, which was animated, because I love his animation work, but it's probably not going to happen. Otherwise, Shaft or Madhouse would probably.
Oh, Tammy in the chat says Trigger.
KyoAni.
Trigger could do a good job. KyoAni as well, but I don't like a lot of KyoAni shows.
But that's not the point. They're commissioning the MomoClo anime.
That is a good point. They would make a good job of that. They could not.
But then they'll just look like every other KyoAni. No, I'm kidding.
That's true.
I feel KyoAni's a bit too fan servicey though.
Mm.
That's also true.
Yeah. Alberto in chat is saying, let Tammy do it.
I agree with that.
Anyway, should we move on to the main event now?
Yeah, I will just say one more thing. Alberto and Tammy got really mad at me when I didn't like the Rennie part.
Oh, no.
Why?
Why?
I still don't get why you don't like that, but, you know.
It's not like I hate it and like, oh my god, I don't like listening to this.
You're in your voice.
No, it's not like, oh my god, I hate listening to this. It's not like that at all. I see the character in it. I think it's charming. It's very nice, but I would love to see like an actual like thing happen after Momoka builds you up, you know? Because that was pretty cool. That was the best part of the song.
Well, that was what the build up was. The build up was for Rennie's bit.
Yeah, I know, but like, I would like to see like something else, you know.
I think we'll have to agree to disagree here.
Yeah,
I think we're just gonna keep going around in circles at this point, and I think you're outnumbered 3-1.
yeah. Well, I'm just gonna. Here's my last point. I'm not saying change it, and I'm not saying that they should have went a different direction. But I would like to see a different direction. That's it.
Yeah.
All right.
Maybe we can ask Marty to make his own cover of it.
Go ahead, Jake. You probably have the most influence on him.
Actually, yeah. I did have a conversation with him once on Reddit.
Oh, sick.
Yeah. It was about MCZ, too, actually.
Nice.
It was pretty cool. That was 2 years ago, though.
Anyway. We have a big topic to discuss here.
It's pretty big.
We sort of touched on it a little bit during our episode 0 introduction, but it probably deserves the full topic to discuss, I think. And the title probably does a good job of describing it. It's what we think makes MomoClo unique to us and why we like them as much, because a lot of us, we mentioned when we were introducing why we got into MomoClo, were like, well, we weren't sure on idol groups beforehand, maybe we just had bad first impressions of the idol industry, and then MomoClo changed a lot of those preconceptions. Like, I've for example mentioned how, like, before I got into MomoClo, I just thought of things like AKB when I thought of idols, and that just really put me off. And then MomoClo completely changed that part. So it's what makes them stand out from the rest of the idol industry and what changed our conceptions of it.
Yeah, right. It's the same for me too. Originally, when I heard idols, I thought AKB, and I didn't like how they really are. So I just kind of assumed that all idol groups were the same like that. But then when I got into MomoClo, it changed everything, like just like you, Mark. So, yeah. And now I'm stuck in idol hell and will never come back out of that hole. So
I don't think any of us are coming out of that hole. Let's be quite honest.
I mean, for me, when I got into them, I didn't even really have a concept of what idols were, to be honest. So, because I was already a fan of AKB at that time, and you know, I was just finding new groups to get into, but they, well, to be fair, the first couple of generations of AKB sort of have the same kind of personable feel that MCZ have always had, but I think. I don't know. AKB doesn't feel like that anymore. That's
yeah,
for sure.
You had the difference of you actually had that sort of, you were already into idols before MomoClo, while a lot of us got into idols with MomoClo.
Yeah. Oh, I mean, I wouldn't say I was. Well, yeah, there was Morning Musume too. I was into also. So, but I never really followed them as idol groups. I don't know. It's hard to explain. I always just listened to their music and watched their music videos, but never really bought any of their merchandise or anything like that.
Hmm.
Like, I wasn't a big enough fan of them to actually do that. Whereas
dive into that part of it.
Yeah, which probably is a good thing.
with how much AKB released, probably.
Yeah, I mean, and plus, you know, for me, AKB only has like 2 albums that I'm really into.
Yeah, and a lot of their stuff more singles. And third ones. Really.
And their first album's pretty good too.
With AKB, it's mostly like they release like 4 or 5 singles a year.
Yeah, which means they have an album a year, and it's just
yeah.
No.
And the elections. Like, that for me with what actually put me off idol groups a lot. I didn't like the idea of.
Oh, really?
You would buy singles to get a vote. If you bought more, you would get more votes, and it's all to pick a member and to vote for them to get to be the front of the next single, which you will then buy. And then it just felt like you've got these girls, and a lot of them will be genuinely nice people. They'll be right. Trying hard. They'll be doing what they'll be trying to further themselves and better themselves as part of AKB. But they, right. I would view that as just that. That's not what I would like in a group. I would like a group where you've got a dynamic. You focus right. on the music. You focus on the dynamic of the members together. I mean,
yeah.
An AKB, by virtue of having so many members, being this all-encompassing brand more than
right.
music, with what yeah. would put me off, while MomoClo, in comparison, have that close-knit togetherness that
right.
Right.
I think sets okay. them apart.
The original, I mean, I'm telling you, if because I watched, when I got an AKB, I watched a lot of old, I'm talking really old episodes of AK Bingo, and they really did feel like they had that sort of the same sort of camaraderie between each other, and kind of, you know, they had that sort of, you know, thing going on with yeah. each other that MCZ have always had. But I think ever since those members have been peeling away over the years, it's just become more of a profit machine rather than a something that you can personally relate to with the
members. Yeah, I agree. Okay, well, AKB, if for anyone who doesn't know, the 48 comes from how many members they originally had when they started, which was 48 members. Originally. Now they have hundreds of members, and they have regional teams, they have daily concerts, and it became a really toxic, just money-making machine rather than focusing on the girls themselves.
Yeah. I mean,
JKT48, SNH48.
You've got the international groups as well, which yeah. have their own elections and their own singles. And
yeah.
if you were going to pick all the subgroups together and all the versions of singles together, because each version gets like 8 or something single, like 6 versions, I think.
Wait, hold
but
on.
The
you
limited
said
edition and standard versions for each of the teams. So
you said international groups?
Yeah, they've got yeah. a Singapore and a Taiwanese group as well.
Oh. They have one in Jakarta, JKT.
Yeah.
And they have one in Shanghai, SNH, and they just got the new one in Singapore very recently.
Yeah. And each of them have
and
their own elections.
And they tried to put one in Los Angeles too.
But that failed.
That failed.
That failed miserably.
Yeah, America's not ready for that.
No, I don't think they'll ever be, because it's so hard to keep track of.
Yeah, I mean,
you have members going in and out faster than an alternating current. Like,
yeah, I mean, that's one thing that is actually a good point, because one, like, graduations wise, I was just having a look at how many AKB members. This is just the main group. This isn't counting any of the subgroups.
Right.
Although I might be mistaken, because I'm not. I will admit I'm not the most knowledgeable.
Or the sister groups. Holy crap.
The sister groups as well. But I was having a look at it. 12 members of AKB have graduated this year alone, which is basically one every 10 days.
Yeah, and it's
when you've
really
got
crazy.
Such a recycling of members, of like going in, new ones coming in, you're not supposed to keep track, and you've not really got a way to grow an attachment to a member in the way that you do with MomoClo. Same with Nogizaka 46 to a lesser extent.
Right.
They've had two graduations already this year. You've got they were brought about of being a rival to AKB and a group that ran similar to AKB. They've got 46 members. They've got multiple teams. They've got multiple single versions of singles, which MomoClo in that regard only really have a limited and a standard edition. Standard will have 3 tracks. Limited edition 2 tracks and a Blu-ray video. And that's all you'll really have. They don't try and... You can tell that they're like a money-making undercurrent to these other groups, while there's almost a higher respect from both the management of the fans to the group to the fans. There's respect all round, and much more of an extent than treating them with contempt and as an asset, which you could argue that you can have with AKB or even Hello Project groups.
I do have an opinion on this, and this is like as far as I got when thinking about this subject. All idol groups are trying to make as much money as they can.
Oh, obviously.
Every single one of them.
There's a difference between making money and completely, you know, abusing the system.
Well, here's how I think of it. What drives each of these groups? What drives each of these agencies to, you know, be successful and do all this stuff? What's their goal? What are they trying to do?
If you're gonna
is it to make
business,
money or is it to provide entertainment?
No, I mean, if you want to keep a business running, you have to have some sort of income. If you can't support the business with
it
doesn't make sense.
And that's what I wanted to check on each of these groups. I wanted to check whether their executives were doing it for just money, maximizing their profits, or entertainment.
Well,
are they passionate about entertainment?
Let me try to explain this. Okay, well, all this stuff about idols and everything about like what makes them successful, everything started experimenting in the 80s. The 80s were a very experimental time for idols, and that's when they found out what makes them successful, what makes the most money, and how best to manage them. And AKB took all this stuff and basically combined it into everything, and now that's how they're so successful. Even in the 80s, there were a lot of gravure, and there was a lot of bikini photo shoots and stuff like that. And they found out, that makes a lot of money, so let's do that. And a lot of idol groups continue that, I guess, tradition of gravure today, and they make a lot of money from it because their main audience, or at least AKB's main audience, is targeted at middle-aged men, whereas MomoClo's main audience is diverse and surpasses gender and age. So it really depends on who they're making their music for, who they're trying to sell. For MomoClo, it's completely different, and that's why that's a reason that they're unique across the board as in the idol industry.
Yeah, and I view MomoClo as there are people that want to provide us with entertainment. But they're not just like doing this out of the good of their hearts. You know, they're not going to do it for nothing. They're still going to try to make a lot of money. They're still going to try to, get money out of us. I mean, we were talking about their merchandise earlier. That shit's expensive.
Yeah.
Really expensive.
Yeah. The jackets, for example, 7,000 yen.
Yeah.
That's not exactly cheap.
Sunglasses. Can we say something about those sunglasses?
The sunglasses, to be fair, are really nice. Branded sunglasses, but at the same time, when you're looking at 26,000 yen, even when they were half price recently, they were still 13,000, which
that's
is
still a
loss of money. You can't deny that they're not making money, but they do it in a way that has a sort of respect, which I think
It's not like Rennie is like sitting down in a chair like, okay, so I'm going to make you pay this much for my hat. Okay, you got to pay this much. No, she's not doing that. You know, she's very passionate. Everyone is very passionate when it comes to, you know, the talent portion of MomoClo. And as well as the executives there, they understand the virtues of their passion. Yeah. And they know they're there to provide entertainment. You know, right. They don't view going to work every day saying, okay, how am I going to make the most money out of all these people that like these girls? No.
Right.
They're going to try to provide they know how to get that money. And that's if they provide quality entertainment and stuff like that.
Yeah. I mean, a perfect example of it. Oh, you go first.
I mean, when we're talking about, you know, maximizing profit and stuff like that, I mean, the first thing I think of is what Akimoto did to the manager for AKB, did to, I think her name was like Hori or something like that. She was like in her mid-20s and she was losing favorability and he was going to kick her out if she didn't start becoming popular again.
Wow. Or, I mean, going on the same respect, like, when I'm talking about the respect dynamic, I feel like MomoClo get a lot more freedom from their management to act how they feel would be best. They trusted, while AKB feel a lot more reined down. And, of course, everyone knows about, like, the no dating policies and things like that. And you see some horrid effects from that. Like, The big one that sticks in the mind, because they've got lots of international press, was the one that happened with Minami Minagishi, where she shaved her head in remorse and put out a video on their official YouTube channel apologizing for being photographed with a guy. And that is just wrong, frankly.
Yeah, this dating policy thing, it started in the 80s as well. And in the 80s in general, the idol industry was a lot stricter than it is today, even for groups like AKB that aren't really free to do much. In the 80s, it was a lot worse. And girls were basically forced to put on a persona that the mask that was meant to just please fans. They weren't allowed to really express their own opinions on stuff. They weren't allowed to really have be themselves. All their main goal was just make fans happy. And what came of that? Well, we have a suicide. So that's not good.
Yeah.
So now with MomoClo, it's so good that they have the freedom to really, well, as far as we know, to be themselves and to show what they are like as people rather than as objects to make money for the idol industry.
Eye candy. I mean, MCZ is like the anti-idol group, I think, because they are in
a lot of ways. I mean,
because they took the idol idea and then like turned it on its head and did something completely different. And now you have this new wave of idols coming around trying to mimic that.
Yeah, you see it with, like, a lot. I mean, some of the Stardust groups try and mimic the same idea. And I think
even other groups from other agencies are trying to do
but
that. Also hybriding it with, like, the AKB, like, Revere stuff.
Yeah. The one thing that gets me with it, though, is that a lot of groups, when they're trying to mimic MomoClo, mimic the color aspect. And really, the color aspect, I think, is...
It doesn't really mean anything.
It's an ingenious way of helping people get into the group because it's easier to identify a member.
Yeah,
When I was trying to learn more about the members, it was good to know, like, oh, well, Rennie's a purple one. Shirin's a yellow one. Momoka's a green one. It helps you learn the names. It helps you learn more about them. But it's no defining feature of the group. MomoClo were the first ones to really push the colors, but it's not like... Well, they're defined by the fact that they've got colors. It's the fact that each member has got their own personality and has got a really good dynamic within the group. And the other group, they're just like, they've got the colors, but they've not been allowed to have that dynamic because they're not given the freedom.
Well, I have to say something real quick as a note. MomoClo is not free of the mask thing because they do have certain personalities that they were trying to push kind of earlier on.
Oh, well, yeah.
Earlier on, they were trying to mimic a lot of what earlier groups made successful.
Oh,
like,
oh, yeah,
for example,
handshake events. They did a whole bunch of
stuff. Right, and the handshake events ended in complete disaster.
Yeah. I mean, that's why MomoClo basically... Well, if what was I going to say? Oh, yeah. I lost my point for a sec. Stardust, it was their first idol group. So they, without having this idol group basis, they're going to mimic a lot of what made other groups successful. But
right.
I think that's what helped MomoClo become its own thing and quite unique, without having a previously established idol basis to go on. They were able to develop the group in their own way with their own ideas, mixing the idol concept, but because it's not really... I think it's inexperience that helped them, because they didn't try and do what other idol groups did for success. And that made them stand out, and that made other groups like them.
I mean, shoot, you know, you look at the other Stardust group, one of the other ones that were going on at the time, Power Age. I mean, they didn't last very long. And they were about as conventional as conventional idol groups get.
Yeah. Well, there was another one at the time as well, which didn't get too far, but by just letting them do their own thing, and just by a mishmash of ideas, they managed to hit lucky, basically.
Yeah, they stepped out of their comfort zone, and now they're influential with a lot of groups that are trying to do the same thing.
Stardust became one of the big players by not being a player originally, and then using that to their advantage. Arguably, 3B Junior, their new thing that they're doing, which KWKM has a lot of involvement in.
I thought 3B Junior was in effect before MomoClo.
No, I think right, 3B Junior was like the training, like what the idol thing was based named under at Stardust.
Yeah,
and
Section 3 of Stardust.
And then they made 3B Junior as its own group with subgroups. Like Rocket Japonica is a subgroup of 3B Junior. In the same way that. Really, it's like you've got MomoClo, Shachihoko, Ebichu, their own groups. All the other Stardust groups go under the 3B Junior name.
It's a little confusing, but...
I mean, because it doesn't help that they did that single where they tried to mix MomoClo, Shachihoko, Ebichu, and the original people who formed 3B Junior and release that single. Like the one that they did in 2013.
The Nanairo Stardust?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
That was pre-3B Junior, but it was called 3B Junior.
Yeah. That was like when it first started.
They tried to use 3B Junior and then put MomoClo's popularity to help it grow. But then MomoClo had already established itself so much as its own thing.
Chad is saying that Angel Eyes was the first try by Stardust. And,
I did.
Yeah, like it's the first actual idol group try from Stardust.
Oh,
and
yeah.
They later made that the name of the fan club for MomoClo.
Actually, I remember reading that. I think some of the pre-indie singles... members, you know how they had lots of different members which mixed in and out. I think Angel Eyes were the thing at one point, and then they brought some of those members into MomoClo, and then they left as well. I'd have to check up on that, but I do remember there being like another idol group which some of the members came into and then left.
That could be the case.
Yeah.
Speaking of leaving, though, getting back to the graduation stuff, there's so many in the idol industry today that a lot of the time it's not even a big deal. But when you look at Akari's graduation, that was huge.
Yeah,
and they made a huge event for it.
Yeah.
And now here we have 12 graduations in AKB this year so far alone.
And one that only one that actually mattered.
It's crazy.
And with MomoClo, it's one in, 8 years.
Yeah.
It's a big difference.
And they had to change their name because of that.
So yeah, because MomoClo could have gone the way of AKB at that point. They weren't with like their, they'd just done their major debut, but they hadn't really established themselves fully at this point.
Well, to be fair, they did have old members going out and new ones coming in, but it was definitely not in the same there weren't as much as something like AKB where they other groups.
Yeah.
They come and go and come and go seasonally. Like Morning Musume has a different lineup every year.
Yeah. Right. Sakura Gakuin.
They're
basically like middle school, so after 3 years you have to leave, and then they've got a new class who come in.
And I'm really glad that ABCHU doesn't do that, even though they're supposed to be a middle school.
They started doing that, didn't they? And then they just sort of went.
They don't really do that. They had like maybe two or three major drops, and then the new members came in a few years ago, and now they're still there.
Yeah,
I think it's like with idol groups or any group in general, even if you're like a metal band or something like that. I feel like usually there's a period right in the beginning where you have members coming in and out, you know, coming in then for a little bit and then leaving.
Yeah, MomoClo had that.
Yeah, I think that's just a thing that happens when you first start out. Yeah, you know, you get people who, you know, express interest but then kind of change their minds and then leave and that kind of thing.
I think the other thing with graduations, which is the main reason I don't get into many group graduations, isn't just because of the dynamic. You don't get to... Because one of the things I like about MomoClo and graduations, you got to see how they like grow closer over time. And like MomoClo, how they grew closer over time. And now they're a closely knit group. And you don't get that with other groups. But the other thing is, and I think... the fact that we had that Amaranthus discussion before with the first couple of tracks was an example of it. One thing you've got an advantage without having graduation to keep the same members is you can evolve the music of the group. The problem when you've got members coming in and leaving is that when they come in, they're going to be at a lower level and you've got to improve them over time, which means you can't really advance the music further. When you keep the same members, you can improve their singing ability. If you compare the singing ability from the early singles, Mama You're a Punch, Ikaze, stuff like that, and then really compare simple. It to the songs in Amaranthus, which are very complex. You've got key changes, you've got tempo changes, you've got loads of different styles mixed in.
The Hyadine track off of Amaranthus modulates like what?
Oh, it goes like so many different directions.
Yeah,
and
I mean,
the fact that they're going to so many different styles now, it challenges their vocals a lot. Folk Mirror has helped with that a lot. They've been able to develop their vocals and improve because they've kept the same group together. While while Sakura Gakuin, their music stays stagnant because you've got 3 years of a member being there and then you've got to change it. So they can't advance their music too far because you've got people with a low ability coming in and then the people with a high ability leaving.
Yeah. And you know, you can hear the progress that they made from that, you know, that Folk Mirror show just based off of, you know, listen to, you know, Momoka and Arin especially when they sing their parts.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Link with where you first got the foot, like... I remember Arin's voice, like, apart from her solo songs, I don't want to say it was bad, but, like, it sort of fell in the background at times.
Mm.
But when you heard Link and she was brought right to the foreground, you really got to see how her voice had improved. And that song, it blew me away, and by the sound of things, it blew a lot of people away.
Right, yeah.
That's why it's very highly regarded.
Although I think she still kind of has to, well, I mean, I don't really like how Arin has to be like, acts like the cutesy one, and she has a lot, she has potential to sing really powerfully, although she doesn't really show it, because she has to use all that, the high-pitched voice all the time.
Well, I think it's the same, just her voice.
No, she can, It's, I mean, if you hear her talk, it's completely different.
She does eat.
Well, yeah, but I mean, usually, like, for example, I use Dave Mustaine, right? Dave Mustaine has a really low voice, but when he sings, he has to sing up in a higher register. Your singing voice and your speaking voice are usually different things.
And the thing
I still think it's I still think it's a trope that they started out when they were starting, and it just kind of stuck around.
I don't know. I think it's just her voice.
Oh wait, hold on. Before you guys continue, this reminds me heavily of the forums. That one topic in the forums. You're reminding me of that topic.
Oh yeah. But
what topic?
No, let's not. Let's yeah. Not. It's I remember that causing a lot of drama.
Yeah.
What
yeah.
doesn't?
Very true, but I disagree with that. I think she does get a lot of chances to show her powerful voice. Going back to Link's a good example. Like, she got to show her powerful voice. It still had her distinct singing tone. It had a bit of a cutie tone. I just think that's her singing voice, which is developed. It's a powerful, but it's still got that style to it. But going back to the original point of how their voices have improved over time, you can really see that with actually in Seishin Fu, where they redo Hashire. Hashire, when you hear it in when it was originally done, and when you hear it there, you can hear the improvement. You don't even notice it at first when you just hear the song and it's on, and then when you compare the two, you're like, actually, you can see that they've become, the voices are much more powerful. They're not being drowned out as much by the backing. They've got more the tune which is going on, but they instead of the tune driving them, they're driving the tune.
Right. I think the only place where I would disagree with that in terms of more powerful voice, and I know two of you guys are gonna kind of get mad at me when I say this. But I think it the voice has kind of gotten weaker in terms of doing those types of songs as Shiorin, just because of how deep her voice is. Because if you listen to the new version of Hashire, when she sings her part you know that little bridge section before the last chorus? Yeah. When she sings her part in Hashire, the pitch correction software does a number on her voice. you can actually hear I don't even know how it got past post-production, but it did. It does this inhuman drop to a really low a really low interval before shooting right back up the next note. The thing is that her voice is like she struggles to get out high notes. She can do it still if she did the proper warm-ups. I mean, you look at her performance during that train wreck of an episode of Folk Mura with Momoka having her issue, and then that later on that time, Shiorin, when her voice just disappeared when she tried singing the higher part during graduation. You know?
All of their voices have changed from there. I think instead of it in few
except
thing, it's
for
got Kaneko. No, Kaneko's has changed quite a bit. It's a most similar, but it's like a more powerful version, I'd say.
Yeah,
I think Kaneko got a lot better.
I can differentiate between the two Kanekos, old Kaneko and new Kaneko.
Yeah,
the old Kaneko, she kind of has like that she has that little cute thing.
Oh. Yeah, I call it the legato. I call it the legato voice.
It's kind of nasally.
Yeah, exactly.
Like she says Toki really funny. Toki or something like that. The later Kanako, Jake said this a long time ago, and I kind of use it to describe her voice. Controlled yelling.
Yeah.
I did say that, didn't I?
But I would disagree with Shirin's voice not being as good in the newer version of Hashira.
I'm not saying it's not as good, but her voice is changed as she's matured over time. Yeah. That's what I was trying to say.
I mean, it has changed, but I don't think it's a detriment to the way she did her part.
No,
was done
I was trying to say that. I apologize. That's
I get. I mean, you can tell the way the voice changed because you would go back a couple of years and she wouldn't be able to do a song like Rock the Boat. Rock the Boat is a song that really benefits from how her voice has evolved over time.
Yeah. I mean, and she can still do the high parts. She just needs a little bit of coaching, I think. More warming up at the before doing it and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But I mean, she can still do what she's been doing for years. That's what I was trying to put across.
So back on the idol consensus.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, we sort of drifted a little bit. Well, actually, no, I would disagree because, I mean, we started talking specifically about the track, but the main point of the fact that. You don't get to see this sort of development with a lot of groups because they chop and change members so much.
Yeah, right. Here's the point. You don't get that in AKB because as soon as they change, you're out. You're not making money anymore.
Unless you're like, you know, Tomomi Itano or something like that and you're still doing solo stuff.
Probably. Or you become a Gravure idol.
Yeah, that's true also.
But yeah, I mean, it's true what he says. It's also with the attachment, you're not going to get attached to a member of a group that leaves the year later. It's right. And you won't, you know, it's not as much of a personal investment as
that
it could
is,
be.
That is unless it is just their appearance you're into. I mean, if you're only into an idol group for the pretty face, I mean, pretty faces are a dime a dozen in the entertainment industry.
So if a member leave, then oh, well, there's another cute face coming in. I'll just get into them.
Right.
But if personality, I think, is better than a cute face. I mean,
oh, obviously.
You could say that for a lot of situations. But when it comes to idols as well, like, a pretty face is a good thing. But if you've got the personality to match it, which MomoClo have in bucket loads, then you do get. I think that's better for it. Well, like, I mean, I've not watched many AK bingos to actually get that idea. I watched a couple in the lead up to this episode because I wanted to get more of an idea. Cause my knowledge of AKB was still very biased towards what I mentioned at the start, where it's like, you've got the scandal, you've got the horrible mistreatment from some of those scandals, like the head shaving, or and you've got the big events that make the news, like the when they got the attack on the handshake event, where two of them were.
Oh yeah, that was insane.
That was horrible. Like I only really know this part of it instead of that. I mean, some of the music's all right. Heck, they did a good song with Labrador Retriever. Hence why when I was teasing this topic on our Twitter account. I posted a picture of a Labrador Retriever in case anybody was wondering about the clue that I mentioned. Labrador Retriever, AKB, Idol Consensus.
Right.
It was a very loose link, and I didn't want to make it obvious, so I thought it would be a good tease. But that's beside the point. apart from a couple of the songs like Labrador Retriever, the ones that have got huge popularity, like, what were the ones?
AKB did a song for Dragon Ball.
Yeah, I'm trying to think of one specifically that the music video has got a huge crowd in a street. They go to a different place and do the dance with like different members of the public. I'm trying to remember what that song was called. It got quite big as well.
Oh, Koisuru Fortune Cookie.
Oh yeah, Koisuru Fortune Cookie.
Yeah, that's a good song.
It is. They don't do bad songs all the time. Like some of the songs are really good.
A lot of it is just very similar sounding.
Similar. Because they've got to, because they can't develop it.
Right. The thing with AKB is that I don't think the girls or their music is the problem. It's the management and how they market them.
Yes. So if you take the members out of AKB, split them into different idol groups, you would be spoiled for choice with good idol groups, because good management with some of the AKB members, because they have talent. You could get some really, really high quality idol groups, but they're bogged down by their management, which is focused entirely on profit, I feel.
A lot of it, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, as Aaron was saying, you know, you want to make money when you're in a business, but...
obviously.
The way that you make money, like, you know... The way AKB does it is just so... It's a machine.
Yeah.
Like, AKB is a machine. Its priority is just one thing.
MomoClo make their money from live concerts.
They
do the whole thing. They do the merch. They do the concerts. Yeah.
They make more from live concerts.
Every other artist in the world does.
Yeah. Like they don't try and sell it on the handshake events or something like that.
Right.
They sell it a lot more in the live concerts. Like MomoClo, the best experience for them is live. That's why they sell live concert blues to even a more higher extent than AKB to a degree. I think MomoClo do actually release more live concert blues than AKB do.
Probably one, because they're less expensive.
Yeah, and two, because they do so many of them onto Blu-ray, because they are such an event in comparison.
Right.
Speaking of live concert Blu-rays, Kawakami, if you're listening, where's the Anime Expo one? Where's the Anime Expo Blu-ray?
They streamed it.
Cameras there?
Did they stream it?
It on Ustream. Yes, they did.
Oh, but that was from his phone. It wasn't from like the cameras they had.
They had cameras there?
Yeah, they showed them on the screens and stuff.
Ah.
Oh, wow. So they do have the footage.
They do have the footage, and they actually used it for news the following days.
They probably won't ever release it. I think they would have done it by now. Who knows? They might get included with a bonus with something sometime.
Yeah, Dome Trek Blu-ray extras. Put the Anime Expo concert in there. Thanks.
What if they sell the Anime Expo on Blu-ray during the American tour.
With the summer, they release a concert they do in America on Blu-ray with the Dome Trek one. So they have a Dome Trek and one of the dates from the America concerts on one Blu-ray.
That would be awesome. Like, they came here. Oh, here's the special deal. We're debuting it here for you guys. We have the Blu-ray from Dome Trek. And if you get it at the concert, we are going to include an extra DVD. So if you missed our Anime Expo concert, there you go.
No, they could do that, but I think the better way they'd release it would be include the Anime Expo concert and the one they do from the November tour and put them onto one release. A bit like how they did those, what were they called? Like they did one in 2012 and they did one in 2014. Those two concerts, which were, I think, Angel Eyes events. It's where they did the solo songs.
Oh, yeah, I know you're talking about.
Those ones. Like, the 2012 one didn't get released for a while, and then when they did the 2014 one, they released both together.
Yeah.
I think they could possibly do something like that.
And I really want those, too.
That'd be great.
Yeah.
Hey, Kawakami, when you come to America, please bring some merch, some rare merch. I want to buy some.
They could do.
They didn't bring that much when they came last time. I mean, in terms of wearable and merchandise.
Yeah. Oh, in the way of, like, everything else.
Yeah, and they didn't have... They had most of their later singles, but none of their earlier ones. And they had later Blu-rays, none of the earlier ones. So
that sort of
I'm pretty sure
that sort of
all
matches
that
with what with at the Dome Trek as well, though. they had a lot of the later singles, a lot of late, like they had the newest album, they had a lot of the later Blu-rays. It didn't have the early stuff. They had the posters for the early stuff, but not the singles.
Well, I mean, but that stuff's like easily accessible in Japan.
Yeah.
Well, at least for the stuff that's not out of print. But I mean, here it's impossible to acquire.
I mean, the only
it's not impossible. They got Amazon.
Well, I mean, like, you can't just walk into a record store and buy a MomoClo album here.
Yes, you can. Go to a MOBI, however you pronounce that. You can get Fifth Dimension Cleopatra Edition.
But I mean, good releases.
No, why would you want that Cleopatra Edition of anything? What the heck is wrong with you?
The one thing that is quite nice, which would possibly be a thing that could do, is they could do the vinyl releases they've done and take them.
They did have some vinyls at AX.
Yeah, like they've got the Fifth Dimension. I got the Fifth Dimension vinyl at the concert. They had the vinyls there.
Oh, wow.
Oh, wow.
And it's a really nice vinyl. Too bad I'm still waiting to get a vinyl player to actually play it, but that's beside the point. But yeah, anyway, I think we should probably summarize the points from this now, because I think we're starting to go around in circles or go off topic a lot.
Probably.
Even since we started talking about November concerts suddenly. So right. Overall, if you were going to sum it up in a couple of sentences, what stands MomoClo out from the idol consensus? One of you.
Anyone? Anyone?
Yeah, I did say that. I didn't expect a silence to come from that.
You should have just picked someone and said, okay, David, your opinion.
All right.
Okay, well, MomoClo has the dynamic in which you can grow attached to a member, a certain member. You can grow. You can watch their growth since they started because there's no graduations, and well, except for Akari, but you know, she's grown in her own path, and you can see that as well. They're well managed. They have the freedom. Well, they have most freedom to be themselves, as far as we know. They're not bogged down by their management, and their management supports them. Well, I don't know how AKB treats their girls specifically, except for like making them shave if they do one thing wrong. But I'm convinced that Kawakami and the rest of the management really, really does support them, and they want them to do their best, not to make money, but because they care about them. And that's one of the most important things about it for me.
Yeah.
Yeah, I have to agree. I mean, you know, you have one thing that, you know, helps is, you know, obviously the camaraderie between all of them, you know, making them, letting them be more like themselves, so that you can, you know, you can, you know, make a more it feels more, you know, natural, I guess. It doesn't feel like, you know, that proper idol image that you get all the time from every other group, where it's, you know, oh, I'm supposed to be perfect, so I'm perfect, you know, that kind of thing. And yeah, it's just the whole honesty about the whole thing that makes them, you know, almost, you know, makes sense. They're, again, the anti-idol group, basically.
Yeah.
I think like MomoClo has the support to they're more human than most idol groups. They're more human. We can see their shortcomings and we can see them overcome it, and the point is not to punish them for their shortcomings, but to overcome them with all the support that they have.
Exactly. Yeah. I mean, again, looking at that that one episode of the folk show, you know, where things didn't go right.
When Momoku's lost her voice, and
but they all, you know, they, you know, had to stick it out for the rest of the 2 hours. Yeah. You know, I mean, you could tell Momoka didn't want to be there anymore because she was seething in rage. Yeah.
To be fair, like, doing 2 hours every month of content for a TV show is pretty impressive.
It is.
It's like a like a mid-length concert, like the full, like yeah, full concerts would be going close to 3 hours, but 2 hours is a concert length, and they're doing that every month.
You know, a lot of it is talking, but there is a good amount of music on there too.
Yeah. I mean, to give my summary, I'd probably say the thing that gets MomoClo to stand out for me is the fact that they vary from the norm. A bit like what you said with the anti-idol group. I think they're the idol group that does things unlike other idol groups. You don't see the sort of almost experimental style that they do with some of their stuff. By having, without having the lack of graduation, by having the more freedom, they're allowed to grow closer. They're allowed to develop themselves. And when you come out of it, you've actually got a group that knows what they're doing. They're trusted. And they've got a respect for the fans, and the management have that as well. Because if you're going to compare it to one of the, like, a Hello Project group or an AKB or whatever, a Sakura Gakuin, they'll release singles or release loads of versions. MomoClo, they'll release a single when they're ready. I mean, heck, I remember...
Right.
Like, there was one year, I think it was 20... The year that they released... I'm trying to remember, 2013 or 2014. They only did, like, one single in the entire year.
2014, they only had two singles.
Yeah, two singles.
And I'm like, release something new! Yeah. Like, in September.
You've only got that and the Christmas song that right. they do. And
well, they did a Christmas single, yeah. like three songs.
They still managed to be one of the top-selling idol groups of that year and highest profit because they respected their fans when they had the concerts, which kept them going, and they had the Blu-rays, which kept them going as well. They right. don't rely on a fan buying 20 copies of their song to make them profitable. They rely on making a song that people will enjoy, that people will then go and buy. And that big distinction there is probably what sums it up the most for me. They don't...
The quality.
They do quality over quantity, and they have a respect that a lot of other groups lack. I think you could say that for Stardust groups in general. I think...
Yeah.
They have a respect for the fans, have a respect for the what they're making, instead of just like, how can we make the most money? I mean, they want to make money, but they want to make a quality product as well. I feel like that's emphasized more here. And to sum it up, like, to just finish it off, the way their music can develop means music like Amaranthus and Haki no Yoke is a song that you almost couldn't find from any other idol group, because any other idol group doesn't get the chance to develop as far as MomoClo have been allowed to. And yeah, that's probably how I'd sum it up for me.
Aaron, go.
What?
Summarize your view. Go.
Summarize my view on what?
What we've just been talking about for the past almost an hour.
All right, here's my summary. I want Kawakami to bring merch. There you go.
Thank
you.
We talked about more than America.
He's American, though. What do you expect?
Oh yeah,
there's only one place in the world, and that's America.
There's two: America and not America.
Yeah, man.
And America, it's just like for Britain, the English, there's like the British English, and then there's badly spelled English.
All right,
I agree.
Thank you for listening to the Mononofu podcast, where we love talking about MomoClo. Very great podcast. We're actually called the Mononofu podcast. You can follow us on Twitter. You can follow us on YouTube. You can email at us. mononofu.podcast@outlook.com. Send us a question, we'll answer it on the air, and our next podcast will hopefully be on a Saturday this time in 2 weeks.
Yes, so you're looking at about the 29th or the 30th of this month.
Awesome.
Which We don't
know. And I will not be late to that next.
Wait, hold on. Did you say the 30th?
Well, the 30th is... Actually, no, shit. 28th or 29th. I'm bad with days. No, it's good for me now since it's after midnight.
Uh-oh.
It's a Monday for me now.
You know what's in 2 weeks?
What?
2 weeks, Saturday is 4th of July. Oh, no, it's not.
Well...
It's what? The 28th. It's the 28th.
Yeah. But yeah, that's why it's confusing for me, because I was thinking 2 weeks from today, and it's the Monday for me now. Because it's, past midnight for me, so that's where I got mixed up. So the 28th or 29th, something like that.
Yeah. Mark definitely has to go to sleep. It's been fun talking with Momoiro Clover Z people. Great podcast. I really liked the bit at the end when we started talking about America and stuff.
Of course.
And the bit at the start where we talked just about food and, yeah.
Exactly. Is there any community stuff happening before we go?
No, because the t-shirts have closed now, so.
Yeah, t-shirts are closed. If you didn't get your signature in, I don't know what Tammy wants to do with that, but I'm definitely buying a shirt.
Too late. But no, yeah. Tammy showed off the design, and the design of the shirt looks really nice. I wish I had a picture of it right now so I could put it on the stream, but I don't have one saved at the moment. But it looks nice. Even if you forgot my signature at first, I'll forgive you for that bit.
Yeah, there's that. I know plenty of Mononofu out there are doing their own little fan bit to do when MomoClo does come over. I'm looking forward to seeing what other people have in store.
Have the SoCal Mononofu group got anything planned yet?
No, not yet. But I do have something to say about the shirts. You guys, anyone, if you know what their shirt sizes are, message Tammy, because she really needs to know.
Yeah, if you know Momoiro Clover Z's shirt sizes, message Tammy, because she is no memes looking for their shirt sizes, so she can give them the shirts.
I don't know what size
XXL
it would.
American.
Well, I mean,
you get it that size, and then they can wear them as a dress. They could wear them with a dress for some of the songs in the concert.
Yeah, American small would probably fit them as a dress.
Yeah, I know for British sizes, I think like a small for Japan is a medium for us, and then so on. I had to get the big size for the hoodie, the Dome Trek hoodies, even though I'm not big, because just in terms of the Japanese size, I would be.
Japan
like,
size.
I'm well,
like 6
foot
1, so it's like...
Yeah, you're giant, so I mean...
Yeah.
I think for US sizes, a small is a medium in Japan.
No, it would be the other way around.
Oh yeah, it's the other way around.
But that, no, because American sizes are a size bigger as well, so small in Japan
large. Whatever size you wanted to tell Tammy, give that size to Tammy. If you can translate... that size, it doesn't matter. Just get her the shirt sizes. You should
find
also buy
somehow.
A shirt. Even if you're not going to the concert, get yourself a shirt.
I'll probably get one picked up. Not going to lie.
Exactly. It probably has your country on the back, so go ahead and get that.
Even,
anyway, thank you for listening.
You can't thank go you, there.
Thank you for listening. We will come back in 2 weeks' time, and that should be it.
Yes. We will catch you all another time.
Yeah.
Bye-bye.
We're going to make Mexico pay for it.
Oh, God.
We're going to make Mexico pay for the next podcast. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you and good night.